probably never seen me make fun of someone before. He shows me, he emulates Floyd, he kind of acts like Floyd, and then he shows me how he would knock Floyd out.
Elevate a momentum where everybody starts talking about how Pacquiao can take you out. Listen, let me tell you something right now. Floyd Mayweather, I mean, he would pick Manny Pacquiao apart.
You as my witness, as any expert, no fighter looks more sensational than Pacquiao looked the other night. No fight, name a fighter looked more sensational than Manny Pacquiao the night before.
Let me sneeze and say Floyd Mayweather. How do I sneeze and say Floyd Mayweather?
All right, hey, listen. You're not sure that you're a real fighting box. You know nothing about box.
What's going on? Welcome to another live episode of Real Fans, Real Talk. You know what that means when you hear Money Mayweather in the background, you hear Manny Pacquiao in the background. The fight that was 5 years in the making is almost here. This coming Saturday, May 2nd, is going to be a wonderful day in sports and a huge day in boxing. But before we get into all of that, we got a whole lot of sports to get into. Let me just introduce my co-host and also our special guest today. To my right, Sean Fontaine, what's going on?
What's good? I'm back. I'm ready to talk about some boxing, some NBA playoffs. You know, I'm ready, man. What's up?
Mark the Statman Skevich, what's going on over there?
All right, back rocking the Rangers shirt. Of course, the Rangers advancing to the second round. NHL playoffs in full effect. NBA playoffs in full effect as well. And the fight of the century, probably the fight of all time, the biggest fight we've had since probably Ali Frazier, is right around the corner, so I'm very excited for this week in sports.
All right, and then on the left side of me, we got some Rucker Park legends in the production side of things. All right.
Yeah, we got Bob McCollough and Daryl Neverson, creators of the Rucker Park documentary. We're very excited to have them on the program. Welcome to the program, Bob and Daryl.
Good to be here.
Thank you.
Statman.
All right. Well, like I said, the Rangers making short work of the Pittsburgh Penguins, the other New York team last night, not able to do the same. The Islanders losing to Washington, went down to the wire in a 7-game series. The Rangers well rested for Washington. They beat them last year in the playoffs. They're going to beat them again. They have home ice for this one. I'm very excited to see the Rangers. They have home ice throughout the entire playoffs. Home ice is very important in hockey. One of the reasons is, other than Madison Square Garden being the most electrifying place in the world to watch hockey, you have the fact that you have the opportunity to see what the visiting team's coach puts out there on personnel, and then the Rangers can decide their matchups based on that. Very excited about that. Trip Young, you were correct as well. Brooklyn coming back. You're rocking the Brooklyn hat as well. Which team had the best chance of coming back, being down 2-0? Atlanta doing their thing, and in the first two games, and then Brooklyn doing their thing back in Brooklyn. So they kept the home court. They represented in Brooklyn. They weren't coming into our house and doing any damage. That's basically what they were.
That was all I asked for too from the Nets. You know, I said, listen, y'all got to represent the borough. You know, that's the most important thing.
You got the Barclays Center. It's gonna be crazy in Brooklyn. When we did the Thursday night show, we usually a block away from the Barclays Center in Brooklyn, over at BPN. So you know, I felt it in my soul, in my spirits. I felt good about the Nets winning those two games. Now once again, I did not pick them to go all the way and win the championship. Cause I do have to be a realist. But my Brooklyn bias, you know, did not allow me to believe that Atlanta was going to come into the Barclays Center and win two games. But since we are talking basketball, we do have our Rucker Park legends on the panel today, Mr. Bob McCollough and Mr. Daryl Neverson. I got to ask you guys, what is your take? Do you guys think that the Nets can win this series?
Well, it's very good to see Deron Williams come alive.
No political answers right now.
No. Let me tell you, that is a true. That's a telling point. That's the real telling point because they have the weapons to do it. Now everybody's been impressed with Atlanta, and these guys are beat up. They're tired. They've lost some pieces, and ultimately they're ripe for the picking. The question is, will Deron Williams come to the table and bring his best game?
Consistent.
I concur. Well, yeah. Because he definitely showed up last night. Yeah. Everybody,
I mean, you need a superstar. So, you know, and he's their superstar. So, out of all the teams, he's probably the only one that is really a superstar. So,
yeah. I mean, I like Brook Lopez. Hopefully, he can keep that strong play up as well. But it's going to, you know, they're going to live and die off of Deron Williams and what he does. Joe Johnson, I mean, he's giving you your 15, 16 points. He's going to do what he does, but it's really in the hands of Deron Williams. If he can actually, I mean, I don't even need 31 a night from Deron Williams. If Deron Williams come up with 25, the Nets can still beat the Atlanta Hawks. I mean, I said this all season. I wasn't convinced with the Hawks, you know, and I thought they were a team that could, you know, get knocked out in the first round of the playoffs depending on who they played. And, you know, we see they're kind of struggling now with the Nets. I mean, we saw Game 3, Jared Jack, he kind of stepped in and picked up the pieces. And then finally we saw D. Will playing like the guy that was, you know, 5 years ago. Right. We were talking about, is he better than Chris Paul? Right. Is Chris Paul better than him? Right. So we saw that. And I know it's in flashes, but if they can keep that up, I mean, I know they only got one game left in Brooklyn, but I think they could go on the road and steal a game. If Kyle Korver is going to miss 10 three-pointers again, you know, anything is definitely possible.
And there's a lot of New Yorkers in Atlanta, so you can kind of have a
now
stadium.
That is true.
They can come in and make some noise.
Exactly. So it definitely can get electrifying in either stadium. Shout out to Coach Budholzer again on winning that Coach of the Year award. Mm-hmm. You know, but Brooklyn is definitely in the house, so I got to keep pulling for the home team. You know, we got a whole lot of other series, too, though, because we got a little bit of trouble in Cleveland.
Your other team?
My other team. I'm a little bit disappointed right now. You know, Kevin Love, it's looking like he's going to be out for the rest of the playoffs.
So he's only doing his Ronda Rousey impression?
Exactly, you know. Which kind of sucks, but Statman, definitely, you know, I know you've been waiting to kind of go in on this situation. You've been looking for an opening to get at LeBron and find a reason why the Cavs will not win the chip. So go ahead, Statman. Right,
well, it has nothing to do with LeBron. It's just, I mean, there's a controversial situation right now. Was the shoulder dislocation intentional? And based on what I saw in the footage, like I said, him doing a Ronda Rousey MMA type of move, it's not like. It's one thing if you're interlocking one hand, but he had his other hand, like, kind of, it wasn't, you know, two hands interlock and you're going with the other hand for the ball or something. That's one thing, but that's definitely not what happened. It's a shame to lose Kevin Love. It's a shame when anybody goes down to injury, because when playoff times come, you want to see the teams at their best. You want to see a Chicago Bulls team with Derrick Rose. You want to see unless you're a fan of the team, obviously you want the other team, you want to win, so you could care less who you're hoping the other team gets injured. Mm-hmm. But, you know, some people do at least. But, you know, as a fan of the sport, as a fan of the New York Knicks who are not in the playoffs, I want to see the best teams at full strength going at it. And, you know, the Bush League type stuff that went down with Kelly Olynyk, yeah, they say he's a little awkward. And, you know, he does look a little awkward, you know, but at the same time, there's no ifs, ands, or buts. What was that left hand doing? So, and then J.R. Smith being out as well, two-game suspension.
That was the backup right there.
Yeah, I mean, it's bad enough.
You signed Chris Childs in real quick. That one.
It's bad enough that you lose Kevin Love, and then J.R. Smith can't keep his composure, once again being immature when it comes to the playoffs. With the Knicks, he's over there popping bottles the night before a big game. Over here, he's getting suspended two games for, you know, throwing a fist. I mean, it's just...
And it's actually on, you know, it was on the anniversary of when he got ejected from the Rondo hit.
Yeah.
the last time the Knicks were playing.
I'll take one over the other, to be really honest with you. There's nothing right about it. But, you know, the emotion that he's connected to those guys says a lot. Yeah. It says a whole lot about him really feeling for these guys and going hard for his team. Now, obviously, we don't want anybody throwing fists at all, but you see this guy is connected to a team that has embraced him. And when he comes back, he's going to come back with fire.
Well, so.
Well, he's even said that, like, it's better for him being in a city like Cleveland versus being in New York, because New York is like the city that never sleeps. There's very few places like New York where the city never shuts down, you know? So you out in the Midwest, out in Cleveland, you have nothing else to do besides play basketball.
Especially in the wintertime.
You know, I only been to the Midwest once in my life, and no offense, but I probably won't go back no time soon because there's not too much going on. Stuff shuts down around 2 a.m. If you're playing basketball, which they probably have the early game, it's still going to be shut down.
You get a lot of sleep.
So, I mean, like you said, he's emotionally connected to the team. He wants to win. He's in a different environment, and, you know, he better come back and do something.
And also, he felt comfortable right off the bat, right off the trade from the New York Knicks. LeBron James made him feel comfortable because he didn't know what his place was going to be. Right. He likes to chuck up shots. He likes to chuck up threes. And LeBron said, you know, we know what you do. Do your thing. Right. And that's it. And he let him play his game of basketball. He didn't have to feel like he needs to pass it to LeBron every time he gets the ball. And he becomes a contributing factor. But obviously, you know, losing both Kevin Love and J.R. Smith for most likely at least the first two games, if you go up against a healthy Chicago Bulls team, it's going to be tough. I don't think that they can pull off. I think the buck stops here with the...
Well, he's been playing really well, J.R. Smith, and especially, which I was impressed by on the defensive end, how well he's been playing in that Boston series. I think that Cleveland will be okay because they have home court advantage in the first two games in Cleveland. You know, if they was on the road in Chicago for those first two games, I might feel a little bit differently. But the way Chicago's been struggling against the Bucks as of late, I feel like, you know,
it's gonna go a couple
games. And they still, you know, Derrick Rose is still not where he needs to be.
But you got Gasol, you got Butler, you got Joakim Noah. They're not just a one-trick pony over there with Derrick Rose.
On the offensive end, it's probably a bunch of one-two-trick ponies.
Coaching experience going up. I think the opposite. I think if it was the other way around and they didn't have home court, you know, then they come back into Cleveland after losing two games. But the first two games without your players, you might lose home court advantage in the beginning and then have to go into Chicago to try to catch up. So,
and what we also can't forget is teams like Chicago, when they play against any team with LeBron, they definitely want to step up and play. They play on a different level. It don't matter if it's like a 0-whatever team. When they play against LeBron, they step up and they play. And Chicago's always been a scrappy squad, even going back to when Nate Robinson was there. They was balling out. Yeah. You know, you got Jimmy Butler. He's balling out. Like, he kind of came into his own or whatever. So, I mean, I think at the least, if there was to be anything happen right now, I think it might be like a 1-1 split in Cleveland or whatever.
The guys that are going to have to make the difference are Tristan Thompson and Timofey Mozgov. They cannot get into foul trouble in those first two games. And Shumpert, he's going to have to carry that load because now he's going to be starting.
I think you guys are missing one point. There's a guy we're not mentioning. And remember, this is playoffs.
James Jones?
Nope.
Mike Miller?
Perkins.
That's just the bully.
But part of that is, that's the reason why I don't have a problem with J.R. Smith getting rough.
Yeah.
Right now, you got to figure out how to get these guys back, or you let them know we ain't punks. But they still got Kendrick Perkins. And that is going to be a battle with Chicago that Chicago might not win just because of him.
Yeah.
So I don't think we
fresh.
Right. Yeah. And we haven't spoken about it. He hasn't played. Yeah. So, you know, and Timothy Mozgov is not, he's no punk. Tristan is no punk. So that's what's going to come down. It's going to come down to Joakim Noah and those guys mixing it up. The LeBron Rose stuff is going to cancel out. But Kyrie Irving, let me tell you, Derrick Rose is one play away from retiring. I don't care. I've seen him. I played with injury. Yeah. And I see how he's going. he's pushing the envelope and going, but you can tell that if he takes a wrong step, and that's so scary, because they allow these guys to get themselves to a point where, like, let the guy really rest. Like, I'm surprised. Everybody's surprised that Chicago's doing what they're doing. He's back doing what they're doing. That's without a doubt. The question is, they're going to burn out Derrick Rose trying to beat LeBron.
Yeah. You saw they did bench him in the last game against Milwaukee. You know, I guess they really are monitoring his minutes because they don't want, you know, a reoccurrence of what happened a couple of years ago in the playoffs when he went right back down. Well, so they are watching him. But
him as a smart player, also, he has to make better decisions, because that last game, he should have gave the ball to Butler. He had three people on him. Yeah. Like, come on, dude. He's had 30 points. He didn't miss a shot. Like,
he's trying to try to
win the game. Like, he'll get the ball up.
Yeah, you got to realize that right now you're not MVP Derrick Rose, and you're far from that.
Right.
And then you should just be glad that you're on the court. You're playing okay, you know, but the turnovers and just the bad decision. I mean, the game before when Jared Bayless hits the layup, you know, Derrick Rose – I don't think MVP Derrick Rose makes that same mistake, you know. But you got to really be on top of things and trust in your teammates. You don't have to take the load on. These are a bunch of guys that made it deep into the playoffs without you. You know, so you come back in and just kind of feel your way out and ease your way back in. So by the time if you guys, you know, make it to the Eastern Conference Finals or the Finals, then you can really kind of go in a little bit more. But you got to take the game as it comes, and he hasn't been doing that the past two games. Shout out to Jason Kidd. So I'm happy for Jason Kidd that he was able to get a couple of wins in. Well, I thought that was big.
Be dangerous, man.
Yeah, yeah. And they're young. Is the oldest guy on the team.
Yeah.
Everybody else is, you know.
Point guard with Toolish from Kidd.
Like, when this guy comes back,
Jabari Parker comes
back. Oh, yeah, it's going to be ridiculous.
I mean, it's still not over.
Well, yeah. It's not over. It's like it's over, yeah.
It's still three games too.
The more rest Cleveland gets, I'll be happy with that.
It'll be like last year, Bucks in seven?
Yeah. Exactly.
Like you said, the more rest, because now they're getting Kendrick, you know, he's able to practice with them more. They, like, Perkins could get with the team more. Yeah. So
exactly.
More time for more Kevin time. Love to heal from injuries.
Six more fouls.
Six
more fouls.
Let's go.
This exciting season.
Let's go Bucks. Definitely is. Now, I want to, while we're on basketball, I want to get into this Rucker Park DVD, because we're looking at the 50th anniversary, and you guys are actually working on the second DVD now. But first, take us through the first DVD and then bring us up into the second DVD.
So, you know, it was really a childhood dream. Actually, I went to film school to learn how to be able to produce films. I went to Cal State University Northridge, and I went because I wanted to tell this story. This was a part of, you know, what I wanted to make sure people knew was going on in Harlem. I thought it was something very special. I was more connected to it because it was my father who had started the tournament, but I was impressed by the fact that I was able to see Tiny Archibald, Dr. J, be with these guys on a regular basis without paying, you know, these, you know, the prices to get into the Garden to be able to see these guys. And that was, that, you know, that's my inauguration into it. As a kid, I worked at 12 years old at the table doing the scores when guys like Fly Williams and all the you know, Joe Hammond and, you know, Pee Wee Kirkland, all these different guys were coming and playing. So I wanted to tell the story. And, you know, fortunately, I met a young man in my mother's building. Mm-hmm. And we'd start talking one second, and I was doing films. He was like bucking the preacher. He was like, I thought you was some kind of preacher dude that was, you know. Very, and I was like, he was like a preacher, fast-talking preacher dude. I was like, yo, man, I just wanted to get the film done. And, you know, unfortunately, I met Darryl Neverson. And, you know, we've been down ever since. Basically, it took us a short while to actually get those interviews done and shot. It was distributed by Image Entertainment, and it came out in 2006. Okay. It's been on, you know, MSG. We were premiered on MSG. We actually screened it in the park, in Rucker Park. That's part of what we try to do. Our company is Harlem Professionals Incorporated, and we try to do events around sports and, you know, poignant, you know, cultural events and cultural stuff that goes on. And so, you know, it was a pleasure to be able to interview guys like Kareem. Went to California, shot Kenny Smith, shot Kareem, you know, Dean Memminger. It's a whole host of guys that are, you know, in the DVD, and they screen it. They air it every, like, Father's Day or Black History Month.
Stuff like that, yeah. Nice. So for me, it was a learning experience. I'm from Long Island, so you know, coming to Harlem, moving to Harlem, and you know, you knew of Rucker Park and Dr. J, but like to actually do the documentary, and this is kind of why we're doing the second documentary, because there's so much information that, you know, was just barely scratched the surface. Yeah. So, and the community aspect, and just the players that played there, males, females, kids, like entertainers, like, you know, everybody. So it's like, we need to tell the story the way it needs to be told. So that leads us into the next documentary.
Okay. And do we have a date yet for release?
Well, there's kind of a couple of different things going on. We were always building out content. Mm-hmm. So we have a bunch of interviews. We shot at All-Star this year. And we had really wanted to not miss the 50th anniversary. This year, you know, the summer of 2015 is the 50th anniversary of the Rucker Pro Tournament. And really, it's something that we wanted to commemorate. So we shot something called Hashtag Rucker 50. And Hashtag Rucker 50 is like a fast-moving, celebratory, you know, look at, you know, this event juxtaposed against other events in Black culture that were, you know, the assassination of Malcolm X, the Selma marches, and saying, you know, there's a lot of other stuff that goes on. Culturally, we go through so much, and we focus a lot on, the, you know, rioting and the things that's going on now. Yeah. But there's a lot of great things that occurred that we got to begin to celebrate and really display the history beyond it. You know, you got, you know, almost 10,000 people out on a, you know, in a park, trying to, on the buildings, on the fences, trying to see what's going on, and it becomes something that you're like, okay, well, what's the good? How can we draw good out of this? And so we did a thing that we were hoping to place. We're talking to a couple of different networks I can't mention, but I think right now we get that going, and then we're going to shoot all the stuff that goes on at 50. And the second documentary, you want to tell them about that?
Well, this one, like you said, will be a network air. It won't really be a DVD. We're kind of making a hour program, and you know, we have a couple of networks that's interested in it. Now, the second DVD, it was tentatively named More Than Just Basketball, and it touches on what Rucker Park meant to the community of Harlem and what it means to the game of basketball. So, you know, when we do these interviews, a lot of guys talk about, you know, during the 60s and the 70s, this was the only time they got to see their heroes play for free. So, you know, you get to see Connie Hawkins or whoever was on an NBA team, but you can't afford to go to the Garden to see him, but you can come to Rucker Park and see him for free. And they're playing against your local legends. So we want to touch on that. And then, you know, what basketball, when Nate Smith started basketball, he started it for recreation for kids, to give kids something to do. And when Hulk and Rucker was doing these things, he kind of did it for the kids. So you kind of get caught and captured with Dr. J and the dunks and all that stuff, and you forget the essence of the sport and the essence of the reason why Rucker Park was started.
Did All-Star Weekend play a big factor in you guys? Like, did you guys get a lot of interviews?
That's kind of, you know, one of the biggest things with us doing this on a shoestring budget is, like, you know, these guys are in Arizona. A lot of them are older. They're in Florida, Texas. And, you know, we don't really have the money to fly all over the place to shoot them. Yeah. So, you know, All-Star Weekend, together, everybody came here. So it's perfectly. Like,
yo, the list is crazy.
Yeah.
So we got, I mean, you know, I was making comments. Some kids we know always tweet us, and they're talking about, you know, stuff that goes on. So I sent them a picture of Cassie Russell, and I was like, that's for you new Knicks fans. You know, I'll tell people who don't understand. But I'm like, Cassie Russell, you know, Bobby Jones, you know, Chris Broussard came and talked to us. We really wanted to talk to people who, you know, had never been there or never played there. But then obviously there were people who were like, nah, I was there. And, and you're like, wow, I didn't know that you had come through. And so it was, you know, Kenny Anderson, Fat Lever talked about watching Tiny Archibald and saying he knew he was in Rucker Park, Derek Coleman, who else? You know, guys like Jim Bostic, who played the original Bad Boys of Detroit. And there's a ton of guys that just wanted to talk to us.
Ollie Taylor.
Yeah, Ollie Taylor.
So I got a question for you. So you guys are doing a documentary, and it's basically about basketball. So at any point was, you know, like the whole saying now, was ball life for you guys?
Oh, yeah.
like, you talk about that a little bit?
Let me tell you, it was so crazy that it was no way that I didn't know I was going to play NBA basketball. And when it boils down to it, there's a lot of reasons why I'm happy I didn't. But, I mean, I played basketball from 10 o'clock in the morning to 10 o'clock at night, and my hands was black. You know, that's all we did. We played ball. And then I went to the Rucker, and I played in a lot of the tournaments. So we had, you know, Biddies, Midgets, College, you know, all these different all-star games. So I played, you know, with and against Ross Strickland, you know, Lloyd Daniels, all these different guys, you know, coming up in high school, we went to the city championship. We played against Boo Harvey and them, you know, and so that ball was our life. That's how I went to film school. Okay. I went to film school on a basketball scholarship. And so there's so many people that are along the road that I know, and we had this basketball relationship, but now they're doing other stuff that either deals with kids, or you have the guys that trained with us in Rucker Park who are working at Madison Square Garden at the scores table. Mm-hmm. You know, Rock and Stu been there 25, 30 years, and they trained in the Rucker. They mm-hmm. got those jobs through my father and them at the Rucker. You know, and that's what becomes a part of our connection. You know, we're all connected. I see Nancy Lieberman, and she's like, you know, I was like, it's Bob McCollough, you know, and it's weird because you like, yo, people know my, you know, they know that, and they know the history of Rucker Park, and we can walk in places and do different things and get access to people. You know, I put out this thing. We went to the Hip Hop Revolution. There was a kind of an exhibit that happened at the Museum of the City of New York. Mm-hmm. And we went to there, and you know, there was a lot of guys in hip hop, and I'm like, yo, Rucker Park's connected to hip hop too. Yeah. You know, Red Alert was one of our DJs. Yeah.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying?
And he was also on a documentary as well.
Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah.
As well.
So there's a lot, you know, there's a lot of different guys, a lot of connection that, and basketball, like you said, was our life, man. We lived it. It's a different now too. I think every era, kind of you gain interest, you build into it, and then you kind of lose interest as you don't know the young guys coming up. So yeah. I stay a little bit connected, but I'm not anywhere near connected as I was originally. And I'll read the articles and get up on players, but...
Now, you also have a little basketball legacy as well, because I met your father as well, who plays a little ball. Now, we got a clip that we're going to... Not of your dad playing basketball, but we got some footage that we're going to run. And when we come back, I want you to talk about your dad being the second leading scorer in the nation.
All right.
If we can get that footage going right here live on Real Fans, Real Talk.
Passing of Holcomb L. Rucker. Teacher, mentor, and undisputed grandfather of summer basketball competition cast a shadow over what was then a community program that saved hundreds of Harlem youth by taking them off the streets and onto the court.
When Rucker died, we felt a great loss.
Holcomb Rucker was a father to me.
Embracing his legacy, two of Rucker's disciples would take what they had been given and turn a free nonprofit community event into a global phenomenon.
Bob McCollough and Freddie Crawford took over the pros and made it bigger.
Pace. Realizing an opportunity, Bob and Fred decided to recreate what was formerly a division in Rucker's tournament and turn it into an all-pro summer league.
Vision, dreams of passion.
Now showcasing the highest level of basketball competition anywhere on earth. By all accounts, it was a gamble. If they built it, they would come. And come they did. NBA and college stars, street ball legends, whoever was the best, came to the Rucker to play against the best. Bob and Fred didn't have to recruit. They all just came, looking to get better and stronger.
This is all that they live for. You know, they want to play down here and get their reputations, you know, and play with the best talent.
The effect on the community was immediate. For the thousands of Harlemites who could not afford to go to Madison Square Garden, Bob and Fred brought Madison Square Garden to them.
And the crowd loved it. We'll take a look at it. What do you think?
Attendance jumped from 2,000 to 5,000 to 10,000 people per game in 3 years.
That's all part of the charm here at the Rucker Tournament in Harlem.
Basketball fans from all over the world came to see the street legends play the pros. More times than not, the street legends would win.
Crowd to its feet. Look at the reaction from the crowd. They loved it, and so did we.
With so much talent in one place, it wasn't long before the college and NBA scouts came in abundance, scouring for undiscovered gems.
It was just a very exciting experience up there simply because of the fact that the greatest basketball players in the world were up there.
If you didn't play in the Rucker Professional Tournament, you wasn't a ball player.
There was only one major tournament in New York then, and that was the Holcomb Rucker Tournament.
I thought it was like a rock concert because there were more people than I had ever seen in my life for an outdoor basketball game.
The crossovers, no-look passes, and dunks we recognize as today's game would not have come about if it were not for the brand of basketball born out of the crucible of the Rucker Pro Tournament. A testament to the personal sacrifice and vision of two men who dare to dream bigger for their community and for the game they love.
Welcome back. Mm-hmm. If you're just joining us, it's Real Fans Real Talk, and we are live right here on BronxNet Television. Myself, Trip Young, Sean Fontaine, Mark the Statman, Skevage, Daryl Neverson, and Bob McCollough. And we talking Rucker because we're coming up on the 50th anniversary of Rucker Park. Myself and Statman were at the Rucker this past summer doing a little filming, and I wanted to jump back in because we were talking about the lineage. And, you know, we're talking about your dad a little while ago. So just tell the folks at home, you know, just let them know.
Well, you know, it's very interesting because we just had a little mini kind of production meeting today. And Dad was talking about some stuff. And I asked him and I said, you know, I wonder what it would have been like if he played with Oscar Robertson. So he got drafted in 1965 by the Cincinnati Royals, which is now the Sacramento Kings. But Big O was playing on the team, and they were basically using my father to get Big O to sign his contract. So my father was the second leading scorer in the nation. Before that, he was just a kid in the street, and Rucker took him under. And he basically graduated from high school, went to college. They were on a championship, the national scoring championship team. He had hit, you know, 54, 51, 57 in games, and wound up averaging 36.4 points per game. He was second leading scorer in the nation in 1965 behind Rick Barry, who we interviewed actually in the hashtag Rucker 50. You know, but you know, I was telling guys, I said, based on the size, it would have been like Kyrie playing with LeBron back in 65. Because he was a scorer and he distributed the ball well. He wasn't just a nut. You know, it wasn't, there's some guys who could score, but they don't see the floor. You know, like that's all that I'd heard from him, you know, and it had been something where, you know, guys say it was a phenomenon. He said Wayne Embry had asked that question, you know, and he said the coach who actually cut him said, you know what, you have nothing to be ashamed of. You are a fantastic player, but you got cut so that we could keep the best NBA player in the world. So that was deep. So, you know, ultimately he doesn't wind up pursuing the league. The Globetrotters wanted him because they had seen him. He was the first African-American to be picked on the Southern Textile team in the NAIA. And they had seen him play, and they were after him. And he didn't pursue anymore. He went and got a teaching job because it was more important, since Rucker never saw him play pro ball, for other guys to get an opportunity to play, because, you know, his peers weren't going to continue the pro division.
Now, you guys said that there's so much to touch on in the 50-year history that you didn't get to cover in the first one. Mm-hmm. What are some of the key points that you want to cover in the second one that you didn't cover in the first?
Well, Daryl always says this, so I'm going to say it. You know, one of the guys who has, he's got 8 rings?
Yeah, I think.
Tom Satch Sanders, who went in the Hall of Fame a couple of years ago, said, you know, and this was when he was winning championships with the Boston Celtics. Mm-hmm. He said he would come back to the park. Yeah, he'd play. He said, but he came to listen to Rucker, to listen to the advice and the guidance that he was being given. You know, that's one of the things that we really want to highlight. There's over 30 Hall of Famers that have played in the original Rucker Pro Tournament that have gotten Hall of Fame rings for the stuff that they've done. And they are like, yo, if it wasn't for Rucker Park, like one story, for instance, you guys all seen the film Glory Roads.
Yeah.
Glory Roads featured 3 guys on that starting 5 team who was playing in Rucker Park. One guy, Neville Shedd, he says, hey, you know what? I wasn't even worried about the game because I had played in Rucker Park. Yeah. So the hoopla and all, he said, I was worried about what was going to happen after with the you know, the social and cultural stuff that was going on. So he was saying, look, that had prepared me for the best basketball that I could play. And that was deep to hear. You know, we were just interviewing him. You know, so it's big. I mean, Nancy Lieberman, who is a basketball legend. She's in the Hall of Fame as well. Cal Blazejowski, you know, played up there. There was just so much, you know, rich. It was something supernatural. You know what I mean?
We got two going in the Hall of Fame this year too.
Yeah,
Dick Pavetta and who's the other one?
Spencer Haywood.
Okay. Yeah, both of them.
So and John Isaacs, who was kind of like the grandfather of a lot of these guys when he played for the Wrens. The Wrens was the first championship team. They beat the original Celtics. You know, they had won 73 games or something like that. So there's a lot of connection. You know, there's a certain degrees of separation between all ball players and Rucker Park.
Who's the best player that you've ever seen come out of Rucker?
Dang, I hate to say it.
Go ahead.
Most exciting or best player?
All right, give us both.
Okay. For me, during a time when I understood basketball, the most exciting player to me was World Be Free.
Okay.
Ridiculous player. We'd love to see him play. I loved watching Tiny and Pee-wee. Joe and Pee-wee. I love watching Tiny as well. But Joe was the best ball player.
Joe
Hammond.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, he was the best ball player, and he basically got to a point. I mean, I don't know if he'll attest to it. There was a time in which he wasn't dunking as much, and he still would have 50 points.
And everyone says he was shooting 80%.
Yeah.
He even said it's like if you ain't shooting 80%, you ain't shooting.
Right. He's like, guys, shooting
50%. That's not layups. He's like, I don't know what this 50% is. Yeah. It's like, if you ain't shooting 80%.
How do you guys feel about the effect that the Rucker Park has basically had on the other, you know, tournaments around the city? Because you see a whole lot of other tournaments popping up, and you know, like Dykeman and stuff like that. And of course, you know, it wouldn't be these if it wasn't for, you know.
Yeah, I kind of saw everything in the infant stages. I even got the history of how many parks guys are playing in. And really, it's attributed not only to Rucker, but there's about four other guys, Pelham Fritz, Ali Edinburgh, Donald Adams. And I got to give it up to Mr. Couch, but there's other guys like Hilton White, who actually Neville Shedd played in Hilton White's tournament as well in the Bronx. But there's a lot of guys who took to this concept. Now, Holcomb Rucker was a New York City parks worker. There was no such thing as parks and recreation. There was just New York City parks. They made it recreation. Mm. And so when you look at these tournaments, like, it's weird because everybody's connected. So my father used to work on the board with Greg Marius's mother, which is the only reason he considered him coming up to the park. Now, then Kenny Stevens, who runs Dykeman, he and I went to high school together.
Mm.
So there's so much connection behind what goes on. We want to see everybody win at this point because it helps the kids. See, most people understand it as a business. And even some of the guys that run it understand it as a business. But it's about people having something to do that doesn't involve them in drugs, involve them in crime, involve them in you know, having sex prematurely just because. Yeah, come out there, hang out, see the girls. But this is what it's about. It's about making connections, doing things that are going to put your life in a better position to succeed. That's what Each One Teach One was about. Each One Teach One program is 48 years old. We'll be celebrating their 50th anniversary in 2017 when All-Stars here again.
Okay.
You know, so it's you know. It's
well, look, because, you know, we have something that we have for you guys to do.
Okay.
All right.
You do that, though, I want to, you guys work together on this documentary. Have you guys ever battled it out one-on-one on the court?
No,
not yet. No. I'm injured. So that's what you gonna cash in.
I want you right now.
We talk a lot of smack, though. We be going back and forth.
We do a little battling out here on Real Fans Real Talk that we're gonna have to ask you guys to help out with.
It's all right.
Shot for
either
shot.
One of you guys can step up and take the honors.
The way shot for shot works, ladies and gentlemen, is we ask a series of five questions, two contestants, one judge. Wearing the referee jersey.
That's
I don't
right.
know if we have two judges
I'm going to be the judge here.
All right, so we got one judge, two contestants. Whoever the judge agrees with gets the point. If both contestants agree, it makes the referee's job easy because no point is awarded. Okay. We don't give 5 points for one line like some other shows do. We feel it's the only fair way to do it. Trip Young is the defending champion. I'm going to try to take the crown away from him. Could you start us off, Bob, with the first question where it says over and under?
Okay. So over and under, 30% chance the Blazers come back to win the series with Mike Conley out at least a week.
I'm going to say no. It's never happened before that somebody comes back from being down 3-0. They're down 3-1 now because Portland was able to take one of the games, but I just think it's too tough to come back from 3-0. Even without Conley, I think the Grizzlies could win one out of the next three games. So.
Yeah, I mean, I got to agree. They're going back to Memphis anyway. I know Conley's out, and it's saying it's going to – it may even be a month that he'll be out, which really sucks for Memphis. But Portland just hasn't, you know, been playing well. You know, people didn't really factor in how much Wesley Matthews means to that team. But when he went down, they really started to struggle, and it's showing that they need that second scoring, you know, option out there. Because Damian Lillard, as good as I think he is, he just, you know, he's been struggling, and when you need that other guy that can pick you up, so, you know, they don't have that. So I got to agree. So we're going to make it easier for the first round.
Bing. All right. So now, who has the momentum headed back to L.A. for Game 5, the Clippers or the Spurs?
That's a rough one because it's tied 2-2 right now. Do I feel like the Clippers could win back-to-back games even though they're playing at home? It's rough. I still think the Spurs is just San Antonio. That's just a great team. I'm gonna have to give it to the Clippers because after game two, the way they lost game two. And then, you know, losing again in game three, I kind of felt like that would really crush the Clippers. But they managed to fight back. And Chris Paul, I think, you know, he has to show and prove. So I think he's really been stepping up, you know. And I think that them going back to L.A. right now, coming off a big win over San Antonio, I got to give them the momentum. You know, I know it's the Spurs, but they got two games left, you know, in L.A., and, you know, Blake is finally starting to come back around as well, so I got to go with the Clippers.
Yeah, I mean, I still think that the Spurs could take the series, but the question is about momentum, and the Clippers won game four. They got back home court advantage. The momentum is definitely in their favor, no question about it. So even though it's not exciting, we are still tied at 0-0.
No, you guys are speaking the truth. That's a good thing. So here's question number three. Was the two-game suspension given to J.R. Smith too little, too much, or just right?
I'm going to go with just right. I think two games is pretty much the going rate for that, so to speak. it's not like in football where we just take it as we come, 7 games, 10 yeah. games, whatever I feel like depending on what type of mood I'm in. Two games seems like the going rate, so and it's the playoffs. I mean, it's one thing if it's the regular season, maybe you do a little bit more, but playoff time, two games, it seems like it's, you know, the right amount.
Yeah, I mean, it sucks because, you know, especially with Kevin Love being out, I really wanted to see J.R. Smith playing, but, you know, at the end of the day, you do the crime, you got to do the time. And it's not even like this is his first offense where he'd be like, come on, you can give him a little slack, give him the 1-game suspension. But, I mean, this is something that, you know, with J.R. Smith, his antics are legendary.
I think he was trying to get into that undercard fight for this weekend.
Yeah.
He's getting in the spirit, right?
Yeah, exactly. So, we got agreement again.
Everybody's getting hyped. Everyone thinks they can box.
What if I don't agree with both of you? There's no point.
Yeah, still no point.
Exactly. Well, we still want to hear what you have to say, though.
No,
what
I think, you know, I think there are times I've seen 1-game suspensions happen. Now, did he punch?
This is his second offense, too. I think last time he only got 1 game, and this time it's 2 games.
Well, you're
so
correct.
That's what it is. It's the carryover.
Yeah, that's the standard. Okay, so question number four. Over and under, 40% chance the Cavs win their second round playoff series without Kevin Love.
I'm still going with the over. I have to. I mean, the Cavaliers, I believe, since February had the best record or second best record in the league. And I, you know, the way LeBron and Kyrie Irving are playing, you know, they got Mozgov, you know, brought him over and got him looking like, you know, he could be an all-star player as well. You know, the rest of these guys out there, Shumpert is finally starting to come into his own, you know, and J.R. Smith, he'll be back after two games. You know, like I said earlier, he's really impressed me on the defensive end. I mean, he had 5 steals and I think game 2, you know. So I think that they can still beat the Bulls, especially when you see how Derrick Rose is struggling, and he's still trying to, in his mind, make the Bulls his team and run through Derrick Rose, and he hasn't gotten out of his own way yet. So I think that is something that's going to work against the Cavs. But I mean, then you go back to LeBron James; he's still the best player on the planet, you know. And at home in Cleveland, I still, I'm gonna go with the over on that one.
All right, we have our first disagreement of the evening. I'm going to go with under, not much under. I'm going to say it's about somewhere around there, 35 to 40% chance of them doing it. You're not talking about him being out only 2 games. If he was out only a couple of games and he comes back at some point in the series, it would be one thing. But you're talking about a non-experienced playoff team against a guy like Tom Thibodeau, who's put the Bulls out there. Against the Miami Heat and went the distance without a Derrick Rose. Now you're adding Pau Gasol. Now you're adding the fact that Jimmy Butler is playing at an all-star level. You have you don't have Kevin Love on the rebounding. The Bulls with Joakim Noah, Pau Gasol. I know there's Perkins and Mozgov, but other than that, I mean, I don't.
Well,
I
Tristan think Thompson is also one of the best offensive rebounders.
In the game, yeah.
Well, you're losing Kevin Love's rebounding, though. So, I mean, I think the rebounding battle will still end up going to the Bulls. You know, Derrick Rose, with or without him, I think they're a great team, and they do have him there, and he is playing well. So, I think Derrick Rose, Pau Gasol, Joakim Noah, Jimmy Butler. Tom Thibodeau is a key factor. The playoff experience with the Bulls versus a younger team and the Cleveland Cavaliers, other than LeBron and Kendrick Perkins not having that playoff experience. So I'm going to go with the under and go with the
Even
Bulls.
With Kevin Love, they would have lost the rebounding battle to the Bulls. Just, you know,
thanks for helping my
that call. That just goes without saying.
It's going to go harder.
But I think, okay, so I won't point out you guys' errant comments. But Kendrick Perkins does have playoff experience.
I said Kendrick, other than Kendrick Perkins and LeBron James.
James Jones, but, Mike Miller.
But Mike Miller, they got a bunch of guys. Sean Marion has playoff experience. They got
but here's the thing. I think something neither one of you factored in. I would have to agree with Tripp only because you guys are saying it like Chicago won a series. It's still 3-2.
And so it depends on
who they're going to face. In that second round.
We know they're going to face.
Yeah, well, that is true because we really don't even know just yet.
We don't. You know? It's 3-2. It's not 3-1.
And they might go 7 games. Yeah. You never know.
It's 3-2. So we'll see. Okay, so here's the fifth and final question. Which was the bigger surprise of the playoffs, the Nets heading back to Atlanta tied 2-2, or the fact that the Bulls-Bucks series is still going on?
Bulls-Bucks series. That's
no brainer.
Do I really need to explain?
No brainer. Jennings predictions.
I would have to agree with you on that one, Stan. Man, I'm sorry.
Oh man,
so you only disagreed on one question here.
Yeah, which means that
I still feel I'm right.
Retain.
About.
I will retain my crown, and that will be another 3-peat. For a Tripp Young to the victor goes the spoils and Statman. I mean, you know, listen, you have to enjoy it and dwell on it. When you have these, you know, victories like this, and I feel good inside. It was a great day. You know, the Nets won. You know, the Rangers are winning right now. The Yankees won the Subway Series against the Mets. Man. You see on the screen, shot for shot winner. I feel good.
But
it shows
all of us.
You know,
I guess we're
Everybody wins. Everybody
wins. You get a trophy.
Right?
That's right.
And we're gonna go. With that being said, we're gonna jump into this date in sports history. And I'm gonna let you guys take over this date in sports history because I'm gonna go pick out a present for Statman. This is live. We do this live. We walk off the set on live TV on Real Fans, Real Talk, just to bring back gifts. So take it away, gentlemen. I'll be back.
All All right. And this day in 1976, Muhammad Ali refuses induction into the army and is stripped of his boxing title.
This very day in 1988, the Baltimore Orioles lose the AL record 21 straight games.
Wow. Obviously, in Baltimore, they have another loss. They didn't get to play last night because of the riots going on there. We'll get into that later at the end of the program. This day in 2003, Andre Agassi recaptures the world's number one ranking to become the oldest top-ranked male in the history of the ATP rankings.
Now, was he wearing the ponytail at that time? 33 years
and 13 days. No, but he had his leg shave, which I always thought was weird, yeah. But then...
well, here's something that's also weird, Statman. You wearing a Red Sox hat, which you're going to have to do, my friend... You know,
at least it's not the LeBron James shirt.
Well, but the LeBron James shirt we had to put on the set because it's a LeBron thing and you wouldn't understand.
I definitely don't understand it.
We got you on the Red Sox. The Yankees beat up on the Mets this past week.
Yeah, this looks real good. Boston Red Sox with the Rangers, right?
Got your khakis. Let me put it on this over here.
There you go. Look, that'll bounce it out. That'll bounce it out right there, okay? You got the Yankees fit it. And happy birthday to Barry Larkin. James Thrash and Josh Howard. Hopefully he put the medicinals down at this point in his career.
It'd be even weird if I had my Yankees jersey on.
Shazam. I'll
move to Denver.
Definitely right. got
to Washington, D.C. either, too.
Now, we got a little bit of boxing going on. We did have a heavyweight fight. Vladimir Klitschko successfully defended his three belts, the WBA, the IBF, and the W... Deontay Wilder, that's WBC.
WBC.
Yeah. And then he beat
WBF? No.
Well,
IBF,
listen,
WBA.
Man, he got a lot of belts.
He got a lot of belts.
And he had it for like 9 years straight, too. He had it for a long time.
That was his 18th title defense. Yeah. So shout out to Vladimir Klitschko on that, beating up on the undefeated Brian Jennings, who was 19-0, went to 19-1. And we're going to take a fan mail question.
WBO.
WBO, which comes from Paul from Virginia, who writes in, is there anyone other than Deontay Wilder that you guys would like to see fight Vladimir Klitschko? Shout out to Deontay Wilder, the Bronze Bomber. Myself and Statman had the privilege of going down to Alabama a couple of weeks ago. That interview will be up soon, so make sure you guys tune in for that. But to answer the question, no. I don't want to see anybody else fight Klitschko but Deontay Wilder. You know, I just don't think there's nobody else, you know, in the heavyweight division. I know you got Tyson Fury.
He's fighting, supposed to be fighting next.
Yeah, but I just want to see those belts collide and see who comes up victorious.
Yeah, I mean, I'd rather see Tyson Fury fight Deontay Wilder first, because I do think Deontay Wilder probably needs a little bit more time to get ready for Klitschko. Also, Klitschko would age, and then we bring Pasha.
And then we next question. He's 39. How long is he going to fight?
All the belts to America.
He's still fighting.
Exactly.
I think he's going to retire if he unifies the belt. I think that's it for Klitschko.
Yeah, he's definitely. He should retire.
Man,
on top,
39 years old. You held your titles for 9 years. I mean,
you can't deny that. He
64-3 right now.
Vision for a long time.
So my man,
we're getting close to wrapping things up. What's your guys' pick on the fight? Mayweather Pacquiao this Saturday. We've been talking about it for months now, so we all know myself, Tripp Young, and Sean all going with Mayweather, but what do you guys got?
Well, you know, we got a little, I feel like I got a little insider information on how, you know, Pacquiao is slowing down a little. I think his hand speed is slowing down. I think he's, you know, definitely somebody who could have a while back given Mayweather a real run for his money. I think just, you know, Mayweather plays too great defense. I think, you know, defense wins all kinds of championships. And I think he plays too great. He's one of the best defensive fighters I've ever seen. And so, you know, watching an old clip of Ali, you know, dodging punches with his hands on the ropes and doing stuff like that, you know, Ali didn't make such a big deal about it because he was such a great offensive fighter. But Mayweather, make sure you don't hit him. Yeah. And so if he can get out of the way of Manny's punches, which have slowed down, I guess hands down.
Real quick, Daryl, because we're running out of time. Who's your pick?
It's a toss-up for me. Okay. You know, I think Pacquiao is going to be inspired. So you know, we'll see.
All right, not picking them. So
really quick, last fan mail question. Jeremy from the Bronx writes, how good was it seeing the Yankees break the Mets win streak and take the first Subway Series of the season?
It was a beautiful thing. I mean, that's all there is to it.
Sean Fontaine?
I mean, anytime you beat up on the Mets, it's great. You know, they play in the first half of the year good. Everybody is hyped. Yeah, so it's right.
Into the
okay.
Yankee fans yeah. and everything. They yeah. shut up real quick.
Yeah. Yeah. Guys, because we got it.
100-0 real quick.
We got to get out of here. Tell the folks at home where they can find out the information about the DVDs, past and present, and if they want to get up with you guys.
Absolutely. RuckerLegends.com. That's RuckerLegends.com. RuckerLegends.com. Our Twitter is at RuckerPros1965, at RuckerPros1965. And we're on Facebook as Rucker Park Legends.
Boom.
All right, there you go. Final thoughts, Dad, man.
Well, we're going to ride out with a video before we run out of time about Baltimore. Your guy, Tripp Young, Ray Lewis out there speaking to the Baltimore fans. So that's before we run out of time for that. We're going to close out.
Okay,
with that.
So then with that being said, make sure you guys check us out on the web, realfansrealtalk.com, facebook.com/realfanstalk, on Twitter and Instagram at realfantalk, and hit us up on the group page on Facebook as well. And for myself, Sean Fontaine, Mark the Statman, Skevage, Bob McCollough, and Daryl Neverson, thank you guys again for coming on the show. We will see you guys next week, same time, same channel. Peace. Roll that beautiful bean footage. I like when I get to say that just for the folks at home.
Sounds good.
Yeah, like it too.
Uncle Ray Ray.
Young kids, you got to understand something. Get off the streets. Violence is not the answer. Violence has never been the answer. Freddie Gray, we don't do nothing for him doing this. We know there's a deeper issue. We know what the jungle looks like, but this isn't it. It's enough of us in the streets trying to change what's going on. Baltimore, get off the streets. Kids, go home. Stay home. You don't have no right to do what you're doing to this city. Too many hardworking people build this city. We put this city together. We put this city on our back. We with you. We know what's going on. We know the problems. We know there was wrong done. We know we're not getting the right justice. We know all these answers. But riding in our streets is wrong. It's dead wrong. We got to go back to the beginning. It takes a village. It takes a whole village to raise one child. We got to redefine what this looks like. We got to redefine what building Baltimore looks like. Because there's too many people putting real sweat, real tears to make our city a better place. I can't come back home and this is it. Kids can't walk the street. This is our future. Our future's in Baltimore. What we're trying to build is in Baltimore. Too many babies paying attention to this craziness. And the sad part is we got young kids trying to tell us how they're going to dictate our city. That won't happen. We must change this right now. Stop the violence, man. Go home. I'm telling you, go home. And whatever I gotta do, it will not happen on our clock. It will not happen on our clock.
Real talk.
Right. Real fans, real talk right there. Uncle Ray Ray.